Good evening. Welcome to Q&A. I'm Tony Jones, answering your questions tonight. Indigenous sports broadcaster, long-time anti-violence campaigner Charlie King. The Australian of the Year, Rosie Batty. The Ambassador for Women and Girls, Natasha Stott Despoja. Families Counsellor, Simon Santosha. And the Acting Victorian Police Commissioner, Tim Cartwright. Please welcome our panel. Thank you. Now, remember, if you've got a live Twitter question, add @Quanda to help us find it. Now, first question tonight comes from Kay Schuback.
Thank you. I was in a violent, abusive relationship with a controlling but very charming and popular man, and we lived in a prestigious neighbourhood. I'm an educated, independent woman, and I had never experienced abuse before. When the violence started, I was too embarrassed and ashamed to seek help from my friends or the police until I was nearly strangled in my own home. Similarly, I was too afraid to face my abuser in court to get an AVO in place, as he still had access to all areas in my life. So my question is, how do we dispel the social cliche that this doesn't happen in our nice homes? And how do we dispel the stigma that keeps women ashamed and silent?
Rosie, I'm going to start with you.
I think when Luke got killed, which is just over 12 months ago, perhaps what resonated with everybody was that I do live in a nice house. I am an independent single woman. I'm educated. I'm professional. So in one fell swoop, I dispelled most of the myths surrounding family violence. And I guess that's why I'd like to think I've been heard, is because if it can happen to me, it can happen to everybody. And I didn't have a history of violent relationships before that either, Kay. It was something that I didn't know how to handle when it first started to happen. And I didn't wear bruises, I didn't get hospitalised, and I didn't have broken bones, but he was extremely psychologically abusive and controlling. So I think your point is great, but that's where I hope that over the past 12 months, whilst this topic has very much come out from behind closed doors into a more public and open debate like tonight, we can start to understand how many people are affected, because it is 1 in 3. And it's 1 in 3 women across all socioeconomic areas and backgrounds, all neighbourhoods, it's everywhere. It doesn't discriminate. And I'm sure that a lot of us here today are here to support that. Thank you.
Rosie, Kay also asked about the stigma that keeps women silent and ashamed in these circumstances. I actually have the impression that you were not silent and ashamed, actually, in your case.
No. Perhaps what I would, you know, the shame squarely is with the perpetrator and the violence. I think I've always been outspoken, and one of the things I will say, though, is you can't always trust the response from the people that you need to turn to help you in a way that is non-judgmental. And that is, again, something I'd very much like to change in the short term, because although there are many very, very good policemen, it doesn't mean that every single policeman treats you with the respect that you should be treated. And again, when you go to court, there are many, many good judges and good magistrates, but there's an awful lot that, again, show the same judgment and criticism. So your journey is as tough going through that process as it is for the abuse that you've been subjected to, and that has to change.
Let me just go back to our questioner, Kay. I mean, you're listening to this. I mean, does that resonate with you? I mean, you said that your abuser was a charming and a popular man. Did people find it hard to believe that you were being abused by such a person?
I found it hard to believe. You know, I was very confused about the situation that I found myself in, and I had no terms of reference at all. And then I found myself, you know, running to a police station in a beautiful leafy neighbourhood, and it was so foreign.
Did they believe you?
Yes, they did. They were great. I found the police to be fantastic. But I was too afraid to go to court, as I said, because we were still living together. He was still in my house, he still had the keys. And he was also very audacious, and so he would sack his counsel and represent himself in court. So I would have to face him, and it was absolutely terrifying, too terrifying for me to even consider.
Natasha, I'll bring you in. You've been listening to this. What are your thoughts?
Well, your story is not an uncommon one. As Rosie has pointed out, one in three women over the age of 15 have experienced some form of physical assault, one in five sexual assault. It's shockingly, chillingly common in Australia, 21st century Australia. And Rosie, you've done more than most in a relatively short period of time to highlight that particular issue, that this is not a discriminatory, whether it's your postcode, your education. We know that there are some groups that are at a higher risk level than others, culturally and linguistically diverse communities, Indigenous communities, women with disabilities, but overall, it doesn't discriminate. But your comments, Tony, about stigma and taboo, we have to address it. We have to address so many community attitudes. It's not just the system that we can point to that is occasionally at fault. It is all of our attitudes that are quite ingrained. You know, 78% of people, when asked in the recent community attitude survey, said that they didn't understand why women don't leave violent relationships. We still have high levels of people who believe that, you know, rape, for example, is, you know, as a result of an unstoppable sexual urge by a man. So ingrained attitudes have a lot to do with it, hence the taboo, hence the stigma. That's why tonight, congratulations on having the conversation, a sustained public conversation that tackles some of those stereotypes and, dare I say it, that inextricable link between gender inequality and violence against women.
Thank you. Let's hear from Tim Cartwright. You're obviously here representing the police, and I'd just like to get your perspective on how difficult it is for women to break that silence and that shame when they are abused.
Well, Kay's story is very typical, I've got to say. There are no boundaries in this. It is all classes. And the concerning thing is there are lots of people who still don't report. We touched on a few gay, lesbian relationships, Indigenous people, people who've recently arrived in the country, who, particularly from countries where the authorities aren't respected, all of those people under report, as well as our own everyday people in the community. You know, I look across to New Zealand. Victoria Police dealt with 65,000 incidents last year. That's more than doubled in 10 years. New Zealand's at 100,000 with a similar population. Would suggest to me there is still an enormous way to go before women feel confident to come forward early on to report to police, to report to authorities, confident that they'll get the support, confident that we'll be successful in protecting them.
Let's hear from Simon. Simon, you mostly work with men, or exclusively, I think it's your passion to work with men in these circumstances. I don't know if it is exclusively, but...
I say I help men understand themselves and women. I help women understand men and couples understand the nature of their relationship to be able to take responsibility. But I just wanted to touch on your point that and Natasha's point that women don't leave. What's been described, violence is very complex, very complex. I liken it to an apple. An apple, but there's golden, delicious, Granny Smith, all different types of apples. Violence, we think we're talking the same thing, but we're talking very different things sometimes. What's been spoken about here is what we know in the profession as a particular type of really horrible violence called intimate partner terrorism. And we call it intimate partner terrorism because that is what it's like for the victim. They're held hostage. Their self-esteem gets eroded to such a point that they question everything. If we were to do a mental health diagnosis of that cohort of men, we would come up with diagnosis of sociopath, narcissist, borderline personality or psychopath. There's empathy deficits there. And it's a very different type of violence that I see. I don't work in the pointy end in behaviour change, domestic violence programs like a lot of my colleagues who do fantastic work with that cohort of men. I work with couples trying to negotiate relationships. But when there's mental health issues, when there's a whole lot of, say, childhood sexual abuse, childhood physical abuse, post-traumatic stress disorder, chronic depression, chronic
anxiety... Simon, some of these issues we're going to come to later. Right. So I'll just to finish your point, though.
The point is, women don't leave because they lose their sense of self. They lose their integrity and there is nothing left. And they don't reach out because there's this... Who's going to believe them? Because in that cohort of men, they present really nice, they have the language, and they're able to pretend that nothing's happening.
Okay.
So the women's voices aren't heard.
Sorry to interrupt you. I'm going to come to other panellist Charlie King in a minute. Next question is a video. It's from Justin Tolley in Nightcliff, Northern Territory.
At the beginning of last year, I was involved in a domestic violence incident with my then partner. It had a catastrophic impact on her, our family, our friends, and our football club community, which is pretty much one big family. I was jailed for this incident for 3 months and was a massive turning point in my life. As part of the domestic violence campaign in place at the Nightcliff Football Club, you are required to speak to everyone collectively and see how it has affected them. I believe that this is a step in the right direction and one that many more sporting clubs can embrace across the nation in changing how we deal with what has gone on in silence for far too long. What do you think?
Yeah, I'll start with Charlie King. I'm sure you know Justin Tolley, since he's a well-known footballer in the Northern Territory. Mm. Give us your perspective.
Yeah, indeed I do. And Kay, it's a common story, the embarrassment you feel. And I just want to say this, that there is silence and embarrassment on the part of men as well. And those of you who are watching that video then will note that he had to read the notes. He just couldn't do it. He couldn't. He had a dozen goes at doing it. He just couldn't talk about the matter. He was encouraged by his club to talk to his teammates. They put him in a room together, the whole team. There was about 60 players in the room, and it included the women's team as well. And he had to stand before the team and tell them what happened. He had to give them the details about what happened. And what it did, what I found amazing about it, normally in a football situation like that, players would walk up to him and shake his hand and pat him on the back and say, it's going to be okay. In this case, they didn't. They hugged him and they held him. He cried and he walked out of the room. But what they got out of that was, there is a message in this for men. They have got to talk about this. They've got to be able to stand up and talk about it, because as long as the silence stays there, this matter never gets addressed. So we're going to do lots of work with sporting clubs about that. Have the conversation about it. I'm glad we're having it tonight, Kate.
Justin Tolley's case was widely reported in the Northern Territory, at least, and he actually makes the point that in his case, drugs and alcohol were a big factor in this. I mean, is that something that you've seen commonly?
Yeah, and it builds up. I mean, it just starts and it builds up. And that case just came out of the blue. He said that himself. It just happened out of the blue. And it got to a point where he couldn't cope with it anymore. And he and his partner both just exploded on the one night, and it just turned into that. It was a horrible situation, but we see it too often, and there's just far too much of it, Tony. Mm.
Rosie, what do you think, listening to that guy and the sort of shame in his voice, and what are you hearing?
Look, I think men holding other men accountable for behaviour that is unacceptable must be a really powerful thing. Because it is about them having to face their actions. And I guess if they, you know, are able to see the damage that they've done, the damage that they continue to do, and how many people are widely affected, putting it out there, articulating it, is so much more, is so much better than trying to contain things. You can't. So, you know, it is... This journey is about men helping men change and men stepping up and saying, mate, you can't keep doing this. This is unacceptable. This is not being a man. This is not good behaviour. And we no longer will turn a blind eye, turn the other way and let you carry on. We are going to make you accountable. And hopefully, you know, that's in a way that is safe for them to do so. It's got to be safe for them too to disclose, because it is about change. It is about empowering people to change.
I bring Tim Cartwright into this. Does that change include male policemen in the way they deal with these kind of issues?
Absolutely. Absolutely. In that way, we are like the rest of the community. We have our own cultural issues. We actually have our own challenges with getting our people to recognise the relationships, what a good relationship looks like, what a role model looks like. Listening to Justin there, one of the things that struck me is he spoke to all his fellow sports people and spoke to people in the club. But for every one of those people, they would have gone home and spoken to their kids. And this is one of the major challenges. So while we talk about the cultures that adults portray, one of the biggest challenges is if we're going to break the cycle, we need to actually get in front of the kids and say, this is what a healthy relationship looks like. This is what it is to be a man in this community. So, yes, we have the same problems as everyone else. We're working on them and we'll get better, but we still have a long way to go.
Simon, is it hard to get men who've committed violence against their partners to admit what they've done, to be open and honest about it and to tell other people and to seek help?
It depends which cohort of men you're talking about. The men working in the behaviour change programs, there's a whole process for that. The guys that I see that mightn't have DVOs on them, some do, some don't, who come in, it's about engaging them in ways they will engage and stay engaged and walking a journey with them in helping them take full responsibility for what they do. A lot of men, we don't see what we do as violence. Say a guy that's lost his kids through separation or divorce screams, give me my kids, with a few swear words down the phone. We know that from the legislation, that's domestic violence. For a man, he doesn't see that way. So we take him on this journey to help him see what he's doing and take full responsibility. It's not apparent, but it's a journey. And yes, they do. They do take full ownership. Some do, some don't. And it's that stage of change. Are they ready for change? Are they willing to accept change?
Mm-hmm. Natasha, are you encouraged to hear that? Or tell me what you're thinking.
Oh, look, well, my organisation, Our Watch, and there are many others in this space, we're in the behavioural and attitudinal change business. We're focused on primary prevention, stopping violence before it occurs, which
is
really
the evidence is that things are getting worse. That's the problem.
Well, it's interesting. I'm going to give you some good news, and that is violence is preventable, but we need to have the resources and the willpower and the political willpower to invest in organisations that provide that primary prevention, as well as those necessities of enforcement, intervention, whether it's services. And I can see there are people in the audience tonight who are on the front line, and so we can't be cutting their services either. But we know... Everything everyone has just said, holding perpetrators to account is essential, and our national action plan in Australia recognises that fact. But we do have to change behaviour and attitudes. We have to ensure that that happens, and we know we can do it, because violence against women, although it's an epidemic across the world and it's an emergency, I believe, in Australia, we know one thing, that they're a different community, cultural, political and economic constructs that either condone or reduce this violence. So we can do it. So when you say, you know, how do I feel about these comments? Well, of course, it's all part of the spectrum. Acknowledgement and accountability by perpetrators, changing behaviour, and yes, young people. Tim, you're so right. We know that, unfortunately, from some of those attitude surveys, young people actually have more violence supportive attitudes when it comes to violence, particularly against women, than older people. And I'd love to think that the kids are listening to me, but I know they're not. So role models through sport and other areas, particularly when it comes to boys and men, but okay, women and girls as well, it's essential.
OK, well, there are subtleties to what domestic violence actually means. Let's go to an issue that's already come up tonight. The next question is from Nikki Davis.
Most people are confused or even suspicious about why victims stay in an abusive marriage. But often, victims are made to doubt their own ability to judge the situation or even recognise it as abusive. At the same time, your self-worth is undermined, so you believe you deserve to be mistreated. And you can become a virtual prisoner, isolated from anyone who'll support you. What is Rosie's experience?
Straight to you, Rosie.
I think your self-worth and self-esteem can be affected very quickly. I think quite often somebody can enter into your life maybe that when you're not at your best emotionally, so you may be a little bit more vulnerable, and somehow you find yourself in a relationship like I did with Greg. And very quickly, you know, violence escalates, as you probably know, and it doesn't start off at the pointy end. It starts off subtly.
I can remember, if I could interrupt you just for a moment, I can remember you saying that every time you relaxed your boundaries with Greg, that you ended up paying for it.
Yeah, I did. As a single parent, you know, it's really great sometimes to have someone to help you fix a tap or screw something that's broken and, you know, just help you around the place. I've got a 2-acre property and there was always something that needed to be done. I tried to keep on top of it, but just sometimes I needed a bit of help. And Greg was always really good to help. He was really practical and he enjoyed it. And I loved that Luke could see him doing that with me, because, again, I wanted him to have those skills like his dad as well. But every time I relaxed those boundaries, there would be some paranoid or some abusive incident that would come up, that where I'd have to realise that, you know what, I can't afford to be nice to Greg. As much as I want to be, as much as I want to be friendly, as much as I want to show Luke that I can, you know, we can be friendly together. But I think that...
Because he'd start to undermine your character, yeah, in the way that the questioner was suggesting, actually, from what I've read.
You know, dominating, making you feel that you're not a fit mother. He'd done all of those things. I was just really, really lucky. It was my house. I never lived with Greg. I had the job, so I had a lot of advantages. I can't imagine what my life would have been like if it had been the other way around. So... for me, I was always in the more empowered position. And I guess that was the challenge for Greg. What could he do every now and again to just, you know, get to me? And he knew which buttons to press. And it could be about dropping Luke off and changing the goalposts, not coming to pick him up when he's sad, bringing him back earlier than I thought, making me go to St Kilda rather than picking him. Whatever he could do to... power and control. They seem little and insignificant things, but it's always somehow it's undermining you. And I would say, you know, it's taken me a long time to feel so strong. And, you know, I guess the saddest thing was when we came back from the UK in January last year, I said to my friends, I have never felt so strong. I'm really good and I'm not going to have the same shit year as I had last year. So, you know, clearly what I will say is Greg knew that I'd finally got to the point where he no longer had control over me, because I'd built myself up emotionally to that point where all his power and control no longer could take effect. And so when we say, why doesn't she leave? Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's because that is the highest point of risk, to be killed or injured. And sometimes when you're in that type of a relationship, all I can say is you have a fear that you can't really explain, but it's a dread and it's a fear of what could happen next. So quite often you stay in the situation you know, because by taking out an AVO, it's going to piss him off. By taking him to court, making a statement to the police, it's going to piss him off. And you don't know what you're going to exacerbate and what's going to come out of that. So you're right, we don't complain to the police. We put up with a lot. Because when you do, it's because you've got to the point where you have no other choice and you don't know what's going to happen next. And there is that total dread. For me, Greg didn't do anything. And I thought, oh, gosh, I should have done this years ago. What I didn't know, months later, he did the worst thing.
Rosie, we'll actually come back through some related questions. And indeed, you made the point, I think, that you were lucky enough, in a sense, to have your own house. Let's go to a video from someone who does not. Sharon Brennan in Dalby, Queensland.
I live in rural Queensland. When I was subjected to domestic violence, I would always leave my husband, but then I would always go back to him. There was no support service available to help me stay away from him for good. There's lots of support services available for crisis care and to help a woman leave, but there's nothing available to help you stay away from him for good. My question for the panel is, why are there no government-funded support services that are readily available to help the survivors of domestic violence and ensure that we don't go back to our violent partners?
Tim Cartwright, let me bring you in first on that. It's a tough one, I know, for you to answer as a,
an
official of the Victorian government, but still, it's a serious issue.
It is a serious issue. I won't talk about government policies, but what I will reflect on is what Sharon said. We experience the same frustration quite often in remote communities. Preferably, we would get Sharon's husband away rather than have Sharon herself move out. Doesn't always happen, but it is, I mean, our primary purpose there is to protect women like Sharon. When you don't have access to the support services, when you don't have alternative accommodation, it's very tough for the people on the ground to get to the ultimate aim, which is to protect her, to protect the victim.
Natasha.
Oh, look, I was going to agree, particularly, Tim, with your point that you want to get the perpetrators out, you want to hold them accountable, so we don't, you know... And a lot of that theory and practice has shifted over a number of decades, but understandably there are still going to be circumstances where you need that intervening immediate crisis support, but, yes, long-term support as well. I think this also goes to the issue, Tony, of cost to the community, the fact that, you know, governments do need to inject more money, and not just governments, other entities, workplaces, corporates, education institutions need to invest, yes, in the primary prevention, but other spaces.
Well, there needs to be a sort of cost-benefit analysis of what it actually means, because of the immense cost of domestic violence. It's in the, what, more than $10 billion a year?
$13.6 billion per annum, projected to be $15.6 billion by 2021-22. I mean, when you start to look at it, the magnitude of the... You know, if we dropped the statistics by 10% in a year, we'd drop that cost to the taxpayer of $1.6 billion. So I plead to governments on an economic ground, apart from the horrific social and personal cost, but indeed, these are interventions that are required as well as, and I know I'm going to keep going back to it, changing minds, attitudes, behaviours, so that we stop this violence before it begins.
Mm. Charlie King, listening to that woman from regional Queensland, from Dalby, it must sort of ring a few bells for you. I mean, the Indigenous communities in the Northern Territory, resources are very thin on the ground. Mm,
absolutely. And Natasha, your point before about having the will to do something about it, that's what's missing in all of this. I think there has to be will on government to do something about this, will to commit the funding to do it. Dalby's only a small town. There's many, many small towns in the Northern Territory where Indigenous women live. There's nowhere for them to go anyway. Even if they wanted to leave home, there's no place to go for them. So it's even more difficult for them. And we know those awful stats out in those communities. Indigenous women, 5 times more likely to be physically abused, 3 times more likely to be sexually abused, and over 30 times more likely to be hospitalised. And we've seen it. In fact, the demands are so great for women being placed in hospitals in those remote communities that the ambulance services now are finding it really difficult to provide the services they're actually funded to do, because they're spending all of their time transporting people that have been the victims of family violence. So there has to be a commitment to come up with better support services. And we all need to have the conversation about what that looks like, because it, one size doesn't fit all. We need to look at it right across Australia, I think. Mm.
We've got lots of questions, and indeed here's one from the CEO of Domestic Violence Victoria, Fiona McCormack, who's here with us.
We often hear, why doesn't she just leave? And yet we know, as you were saying earlier, Rosie, that this is a time when women and children are at most at risk, violence escalates, and we can even see family violence-related homicides. It's a question to all the panel. I'm interested to know what you think we could do to support women to keep them safe when they end relationships.
I'll start with Simon, since we haven't heard from you in the last question or so.
The best thing we can do, and I'm this is why I do the work that I do, if we want to protect women and children from harm, we engage the blokes. We engage the blokes early in ways they will engage and stay engaged. As we know, I work a lot with separated men. And separated men, we know there's high incidence of domestic violence increases, high rates of suicide, high rates of trauma during that very vulnerable time. Close to 70% of women separate or initiate the separation, and a lot of guys, they don't cope. They don't have the skills to cope. And left on their own, sometimes their brain goes into what we call irrational cognitive thoughts, and they can act on those irrational cognitive thoughts. So sitting with the bloke, saying, mate, what do you want? What are you doing? You tell me you want to see your kids. So on a handover, when you tell your ex-partner what you really think of her, is that really getting you what you want? Now let's maybe bring her into the picture imaginatively on the couch. If she was there, how would she perceive your behaviour? And then we can start a conversation and start to move him forward and start to help him process his grief, loss, anger, sense of powerlessness, helplessness over here. While there's a framework that says men have the patriarchal control, a lot of men who have been left feel powerless. Yes, there's frameworks that say he's powerful, but that man feels he's powerless. And the best protection we can give women and children is to help him understand he has choices. He has choices to escalate his behaviour, or he has choices to take full responsibility for his behaviour and form a respectful co-parenting relationship with his co-parents for the sake of his children. And bringing the children into the picture and the kind of father that maybe how he got fathered, the type of father he thought he would be and the type of father he is. And for a lot of guys, the change moment, that stage of change moment, is when they've realised they're fathering how they were fathered. And they never wanted to set out like that. They wanted to be better fathers. So we need to work with the women. I'm very, very strong about that. But to protect the women, we need to work with the blokes.
A very brief answer to this, but what's happened to the services dealing with men in these circumstances? We're talking about funding earlier, and I'm just interested to know.
In the early prevention intervention side of things, no one knows about this, but in 1996 to 2011, there was a groundbreaking program called the Men and Family Relationship Program. It was designed to connect with men where men are at, in blokey type ways, in football clubs, in community centres, to run parenting programs for new dads, to connect with blokes who are going through separation or divorce. In 2011, 2012, it got rolled into a general family program, and the emphasis on men got lost. So there's been close to 30 or 40% reduction in those early intervention prevention services. Men don't set out to be violent. Often it's a progression. There's a series of events that happen, and unless we can get to them early and help them change the way they perceive the situation, then terrible things can happen. So those were services, and along with the behaviour change.
Okay, Simon, I'm going to cut you a bit short there. You can come back to some of these issues.
Okay.
I want to hear Rosie Batty on the question that was asked and reflecting on what Simon's just been saying.
So the question, Fiona, why doesn't she leave? Well, what I want to say is probably don't want to. You know, there are many reasons why somebody doesn't leave a relationship, and they don't want to leave. They just want the violence to stop. Why would you want to leave your home, your family? You know, the dreams that you had. You've built a home. You've got a family. You know, the family that you wanted to have. You know, nobody wants to leave something that they've built and tried to build and leave the dream that they had. So it's hard for anyone to extricate themselves out of any relationship over a long time, you know.
Well, particularly when, I'll just sort of interrupt there, because I think Fiona's question went to, in fact, I'll go back to Fiona, because I know your question went to the point of how dangerous it is at that point when someone does decide to leave. Just want to...
Yeah, Rosie, it's more what can we do?
Yeah.
And I'm looking at innovation and I hear a point about counselling for men, but we've had 14 women murdered in Australia, and it's not even the end of February this year. Now, that's twice the national average. So I'm thinking, what can we do as a system better to protect women around that time.
And that's my point, is that you don't want to leave either out of fear, or you don't want to leave because you don't want to leave your home. You want the violence to stop. What we would really want are effective programs for men to be given that opportunity to change their behaviour. And I think that's where it comes to so much, is perpetrator intervention programs. It's not the only answer, but that is a key step.
So I'll just hear from Tim on that. What are your thoughts?
Fiona, I was just thinking of a simple thing, and you're talking about innovation, but this is an innovation. A lot of this is cultural, and a lot of this we hear from the people in the audience. The first thing we need to do is acknowledge and believe the woman. So you're talking about right down the track. But time and again, I hear from women in these situations who say, well, the first thing I needed to do was hear someone believe me. And for us, that's usually the policeman or the policewoman who attends that night, usually it's at night, believe them. But then that's something that we can all do. I think one of the things that we need to do as a community is to support women in these situations, as friends, as family, as leaders in the community. And this is part of that cultural change. If we all stand up and say, no, this is not the way we want this community to be, and we believe in the women who come to us and report these crimes, then we'll have made a big difference.
OK, we've got another video question. This one's from Virginia Watson in Shoalhaven Heads, New South Wales.
I'm a domestic violence support worker on the south coast of New South Wales. I have women come to me and look me in the eye and say, it is only a matter of time before he kills me. My question to the panel tonight is, how can we keep women and children safe from violent repeat offenders when current sentencing trends don't seem to deter?
Natasha, can I start with you?
Oh, well, this relates also to Fiona's question as well.
Yep.
And again, Tim, you're right on changing attitudes, but it's that combination of enforcement as well as cultural and community change. We have to have effective AVOs. We have to have shared practice and evidence among the jurisdictions. We need to share information so that people don't go from one jurisdiction to the next and escape, you know, or have impunity. We need to, you know, ensure that women feel free to speak up, that policemen and women will believe her, that bystanders will understand that there is a role for intervention as well as believing but changing attitudes. We need to ensure that the courts and the judiciary understand that this is a national emergency and that we need to enforce legislation and policy as it exists, or indeed change it. And this goes to the question, change it where it is failing. And we've seen changes in recent times to family law, both negative changes in 2006, I remember it well, in a former life, and 2012 we've seen changes to family law that now are starting to rebalance that sense of putting more weight on protecting and not harming children and mothers in most instances, but women, even if it's at the expense of the so-called meaningful relationship with both parents. So there are legal, judicial, enforcement, a range of changes, but
let me hear from Tim Cartwright. Is it actually frustrating for the police, the way the courts deal with matters like this?
There's a whole lot of frustration
and for
police, just as there are for the victims in this. But one of the things is the nature of the Federation is the court orders don't transfer automatically. So if someone's a victim of a family violence incident today in New South Wales and they cross across the border tomorrow into Victoria, the people on the ground, the men and women who are there to protect the victim, can't get access to that information easily. The systems that are in place to register that order require the woman to go into court to actually manually enter it. It is an archaic system. So that is a great frustration for us. We don't have access to mental health information. We don't have access to alcohol information. We don't have all sorts of information which might help us on the ground protect the woman, or at least understand the situation and understand the risk that we're seeing.
OK, we've actually got another question that relates to this. I'll go straight to it. It's from Nicole Ryan. We'll hear from the other panellists on this. Nicole.
As someone who survived living with domestic violence, I would like to ask the panel a question based on what I have experienced.
The police in my area seem to be stepping up their efforts against domestic violence, but the court system is lagging behind. In my case, my ex-partner breached his orders over and over again, each time still managing to walk out of court, leaving us vulnerable. How are me and my children able to rely on a system that's meant to protect us?
Rosie, I'll come to you. I think it's fair to say that system let you down rather horribly.
Look, I think there were a lot of factors in my situation, and I don't know that I blame the system entirely, but I think that the system can greatly improve. And as we say, we work a lot in silos, and if there was some kind of coordinated approach where a continuum of violence was monitored and looked at, that would be a great help. I think, you know, I have great faith in our police force in Victoria. I can see the improvements. I can see the transparency, their keen desire to continue to improve and evolve, and their passion for family violence. And so that huge organisation that seeks to do better, I just hope that passes through into the court process. I understand there's quite a lot of revision of what's happening in courts right now, and I do think you will see some dramatic changes and improvements. But currently, you know, a breach is a breach. If we don't put any great weight onto it being a crime, what is the point?
Rosie, yeah. In a way, it's bringing you back to the story you didn't finish earlier, because you told us how you went on a holiday with Luke, and when you came back, in fact, by the time you got back, there were a whole lot of things happened that you didn't know about.
Yeah.
Greg had 4 warrants for his arrest. He threatened to kill someone. He'd been charged with looking at child pornography. All of these things, all of these were red flags. No one told you about it. So when he turned up at that sports ground, you simply didn't know.
At this point, the way that we handle domestic violence, as family violence, as I understand it, no one's looking for red flags. They are called out for, you know, individual instances where you go and make a statement, and then you've got your court appearance, and then they don't turn up at court, so that gets adjourned, and so it's an ongoing circus that, you know, for myself, I didn't realise people didn't turn up at court. I'd never been involved with court before, so I assumed everyone turned up. What you begin to realise is the court system is, you know, people don't turn up all the time. So then it becomes normalised, and then your case becomes stale. So then all of a sudden your case is not that urgent because he hasn't done anything the last couple of months, so he's not likely to do, you know. So there is that incorrect assumption that makes you even safer. Well, violence is a continuum. Without intervention, it will always escalate and get worse. Mm. Always.
Simon wants to get in. I just want to quickly come to Tim first. Now, all of these things that happened, should they not have been passed on to the woman, in fact, to the family most at risk?
Well, can I first come back to the point is we need to assess the risk ourselves. Whether we communicate with a woman or not, we need to communicate the risk, and we need to understand all those factors. Rosie's had this conversation with us before. We didn't get it right. We will improve, we continue to improve, but it is a really tricky situation. Sometimes legislation will prevent us passing on that information.
Privacy legislation?
Maybe privacy legislation, sometimes health legislation, sometimes legislation that's even designed to protect the woman will backfire and not allow us to communicate. But regardless of that, there is nothing that would stop us communicating the risk to the victim. So we should be saying to the victim, this is what we assess, and we should be picking up those risk factors. We're better at it now in Victoria. We're much better, but we haven't always got it right in the past, and I'm sure we'll make mistakes again in the future. This is a very complex problem. We know that Victoria, 65,000 incidents last year, and we've probably got another 40 or 50,000 that aren't reported.
Okay, Simon, quick response. We've got to move on to other
questions. Just on the Gold Coast, we have what's called an integrated response. So when someone comes to the attention of domestic violence and there's been repeated breaches and that person's doing a mandated program, then everybody is informed. The police, the CHOP, protection, mental health, everyone gets together. It's quite a... I think it's only one of two integrated models where all different service agencies actually do talk to each other to protect women from misinformation, for that important information that should have been passed on but wasn't.
Thank you, Simon. Our next question is a video. It's from Megan Hale in Mildura, Victoria.
I am 19. I've been sexualised by men my whole life. I do not feel safe when I'm alone in public, and my experiences have taught me that boys my age feel entitled to my body. I do not feel equal to men in Australian society at all. Can the men on the panel acknowledge that there is a lot of entrenched misogyny in Australia, and what are they going to do to get other men to take gender inequality and male violence seriously?
Okay, Megan asked... Thank you. Megan asked, we'll start with the men, I'll start with Charlie King.
Yes, through the domestic violence action plans that we're trying to put in place, we're encouraging men to deal with all of those issues, to be able to understand all of those issues, and written.
Do you think
into
there's
those...
entrenched misogyny?
Oh yeah, I'm sure there is. I'm sure there is, but I think we need to have that discussion with men, and so we develop these domestic violence action plans with sporting clubs to get men to be part of the discussion. So hopefully, when we push that further on, men will get to learn more about this. You know, I think that's the problem. Men just don't understand this, I don't think.
Tim?
Yeah, absolutely. There is entrenched misogyny, and sometimes it's subtle. And when it's subtle, that is the greatest challenge, because men often don't realise what it is they're doing. They don't realise they're undervaluing women. They don't realise they're treating women as property or some way of reflecting their status. So sometimes it's difficult to change those perceptions when men don't understand it. So that's one of the reasons, I think, we're here tonight. It's one of the opportunities we have.
Simon?
I'm very passionate about this subject. I've got a history of working with sexually abused kids and teenagers, and I was the first male in 18 years that Family Planning Queensland had to go into schools to deliver healthy sexuality education. And I still go into schools to work with the young men about respectful relationships, how do you negotiate consent and pornography. And one of the biggest dangers we now face is our mobile phones. That 12-year-olds with internet connectivity can type in Google Pictures. Now, there's a big movie out at the moment that everyone's raving about. You type bondage into Google Pictures, see what comes up. 12, 13, 14, 15-year-olds who are still developing their sexual identity, their cognitive pathways, are watching these images, and it's shaping what they perceive women want. And no one is telling them otherwise. Where are the parents? Where are the fathers? When I worked with Family Planning, the organisation was very big about parents sitting down and using educational opportunities like the movie that's out at the moment, 50 Shades, and use that as a learning and teaching opportunity for healthy relationships. If it doesn't start with us, the parents, all they've got is the mobile phone and internet pornography to get their ideas on how to treat women. And that's frightening. That really is frightening.
Natasha.
Yeah. Start with that last point. 50 Shades of Grey has done us no favours, I can tell you that. And that's just not only a literature review, just quietly.
Look, I'm just glad I didn't say that was my favourite film.
There are key things here. International evidence tells us very clearly there are two key predeterminants when it comes to the issue of violence against women, gendered violence. We know one of them is gender stereotyping and those rigid gender roles that probably do men and women no favours. Mm. And secondly, inequality. the economic, social, political inequality that exists in our societies. Political inequality, yep, I could talk about that. I know to this...
Please don't.
But what we do need, whether it's healthy, respectful relationships, education, whether it's role models that are not the hyper-masculine men on the one hand, we need strong, powerful female role models. Yes, I knew that when I got into Parliament 20 years ago. I understood it the other, 2 years ago when my daughter, who is now six, didn't understand when Kevin Rudd became Prime Minister after Julia Gillard because she thought boys couldn't be Prime Ministers. So we have to remember that, Tony, role models make a difference. Respectful education makes a difference. And it's not only the parents, it's every sector, workforce, it's corporate, and it's getting to the education system, as everyone said. Mm. And, you wonder about gender inequality. This is why you've had feedback on the panel tonight, because it matters how we're reflected and represented in society. That's why we get upset about being in the minority.
Can I just quickly, very briefly. When I go into schools and I say to the young Year 11 and 12 boys, a man needs to be what? And then I brainstorm the answers. A man needs to be tough, and a man needs to be strong, a man needs to be provider. You can't show feelings, and you have to be in control. And I have a different version. A man can be flexible. That's a rigid stereotype. And I help them understand that a man can feel, a man can feel pain, a man can take responsibility, a man can cry, and that's still a very manly thing to do. And we need to look at the messages that we get from the media, from our own modelling, from our own parenting, and start to do that generational change.
And of course, simply make the point that when we're having a discussion like this, it is very good to hear from men because they are a key part of the problem, and that's why we're doing this. Next question is from Armin Abrahimzada.
In March 2010, my mother was murdered by my father at the Adelaide Convention Centre in front of about 300 people. Prior to this incident, my mother, my sisters and I were living in a volatile and abusive environment. I believe her murder was preventable and that prevention work is essential to eliminating family violence. It tackles the root causes of violence, not the consequences, as many families, just like my family, have experienced. I'm an extremely proud White Ribbon Ambassador and I believe in and support their campaign. And my question to the panel is, how do you see the future of violence prevention strategies that particularly target men?
Okay, I'll start with Charlie.
Well, it's a tough question to have to deal with, but there's no doubt that we just have to have a conversation with men, White Ribbon does that. There are other programs that do it as well, but we have to bring men to the table. Men find this really difficult to talk about. It's not an issue that, we've mentioned this already, it's not an issue that they're comfortable talking about, but we've got to get them to talk about it. We need men's groups to meet with other men to encourage them to actually talk about this issue. And I can't see any other way that we can do this other than getting men together to talk about this and make them understand what is actually happening out there. Because I'm convinced men don't know the damage that's happening out there. In fact, I know that. I've spoken to men many times about them, say, here are the statistics. This is what's happening in our country. And the old Indigenous men that I've spoken to over the years would look at me and say, no more, no more, we have to stop this, and that they feel that, but how do we actually do that? So we have the conversation and then we have to start planning a way in which we could do that. There's so much to be done in this space, and I'm sorry that you've gone through, Armin, what you have.
Can I just go back to Armin, just listening to what you were saying, do you believe there were things that could or should have been done?
Oh, yes,
make sure
we were
that...
let down by the system.
Yeah, tell us what, briefly.
My father was flagged, he was a wanted man. We went to court and he was never caught, even though there was assault and threats that were reported to the police. I mean, there was a ministerial inquiry into my mother's death. There was a coronial inquest into her death. And all these failings came out. But unfortunately, it's too late for us. But if something can be improved or changed, then we would like to see that.
Can I just ask, it's a very personal question, but do you have any idea what was going on in his head? Have you ever been able to... Would you even consider sitting down and talking to him about it? I know he's in jail.
I'd like to give him a piece of my mind.
Yeah. Rosie, I've got to ask what went through your mind when you listened to that story.
I think I'd do anything to have Luke back, but I'm really pleased that Greg died. When I say that, I think it would be a very different journey for me to go through a criminal trial and all of the pressures that I'm sure you've had to go through. It's been bad enough what I've had to go through, but to have to deal with Greg doing what he did and being still alive would be different for me, I know. There's so many other tragic deaths. And you can't understand how they could ever get to that point. But one of the things I will say is, you know, the police do a very good job a lot of the time, but they are let down too by the mental health interventions that are really non-existent, very, very limited. They don't look at an incidence of violence through the lens of family violence. They're really not invested in any kind of prevention or treatment. They're really just a tick in the box exercise, and out they go on the street again because they haven't got the facilities and they haven't got the support to actually seriously help someone. And what I found very distressing with my coronial inquest is, you know, I knew Greg had a mental illness. Mental illness isn't the cause of violence, but it certainly is something that needs treatment. And unfortunately, he didn't have that intervention. So, you know, how he arrived at what he did was not the man 5 years earlier. So it's really hard to make sense of what they did. But I do think that, you know, if the red flags are there, we have to have the interventions, because otherwise they're on a path of destruction. And you look back later and you go, you know what, that was a red flag, that was a red flag, that was a red flag. I've got all the red flags. And nobody really understood the severity of the path that Greg was heading down either.
Natasha, I'll bring you in on the last part of the question, which is the future of violence preventative strategies.
Primary prevention, absolutely. I just want to acknowledge this family and the situation in South Australia. You have changed lives already. You're not only proud White Ribbon ambassadors, and we have White Ribbon ambassadors and our Watch ambassadors on the board tonight, but we've given a lot of shtick to government tonight, but the South Australian government joined our Watch and has also come up with a series of recommendations that also relate to primary prevention as a result of this coronial inquiry, because they've recognised that, yes, investing in primary prevention strategies and, as I've mentioned before, engaging institutions, whether it's workplaces, whether it's schools, whether it's engaging the community in a sustained public conversation where we actually have these difficult conversations about, yes, gender inequality. We talk about the failures in the system. So the future, very much in schools, Tony. I'm always going to re-emphasise and emphasise schools, but bystander education or the Commonwealth's program On the Line, which is helping 12 to 20-year-old and young people to learn about some of those issues, Simon, to which you referred. But let's just... There is a backdrop here very quickly. You know...
Royal
Commission in Victoria starts today. South Australia has an inquiry reporting soon. The Queensland Task Force reports soon. A Senate inquiry comes down soon. There is some momentum building, and I think that's something to remember. Resources, yes, we need more, but there's an understanding that prevention is where it's at, but not at the expense of services and intervention as well.
OK, we've got time for a couple more questions. Thank you. The next question is from Steve Coe.
Latest available research from the ABS 2012 Personal Safety Survey and the Australian Institute of Criminologies indicates that at least one in three of victims of family violence in intimate relationships happen to be the men. and the perpetrator significantly happened to be the woman. And I should know because I must say I am a victim. I was a victim. I was assaulted and I suffered immensely with psychological trauma. But the thing is that nobody believed me. The police, social worker, the court system, not even me mates. You see, I just happened to be a bloke. So I asked the panel, how do we raise awareness to recognize and help the male victims of family violence as in such a way that we don't take away all the good work we already have in preventing violence against women?
Simon, you can start us off.
And that's a really good question because when we're focusing on the majority, which is what we are at the moment, that far more women get harmed, minority voices get lost in this. Some of the minority voices that experience violence, I'm seeing an increase on the Gold Coast, and indeed we are nationally, of adolescent sons abusing their mothers, especially when there's not another bloke around to say, hey mate, step it down. That's a problem. Elder abuse is a huge problem. Same-sex relationships is a huge problem in domestic violence and men. And those, especially with men, because we have this stereotype that women can't be violent. So it's a bit icky for us to take that on board. And they are marginalised and there's no service provision. I think we have to invite those minority people into the conversation so what we're talking about tonight doesn't exclude them. I really think that's important.
Natasha, there is a push from some sectors for gender-neutral services. What are your thoughts?
Well, first of all, men and women, boys and girls, can be the subject of domestic, family, violence and sexual assault. The ABS statistics are very clear, though, that women are three times more likely to be such victims. Can I say, though, that anyone who is the victim of violence deserves to be heard, believed, supported. There's no question about that. Violence happens to different groups, as we've discussed. It also happens not only in heterosexual relationships, it happens in homosexual relationships as well. The vast majority of perpetrators are men, and that's why it's considered very much a gendered issue across the world and here in particular. So when you talk about neutrality, yes, we have to engage men. You've heard very good reasons tonight from everyone on the panel as to why that is critical, while behavioural change is critical. But also we have to recognise, as I mentioned before, there are some key determinants as to why we have violence to this extent, to this severity, and understanding that there are different definitions of the severity and the impact on women who are disproportionately affected. When you take that into account, we have to acknowledge that this is still a gendered issue. So neutrality doesn't always cut it. You've said it, Charlie, tailored programs, targeted programs, one size fits all doesn't work. There is a gender aspect to this issue, and that is not to say that other
quick
people,
response
men
if you're going
can't
to get
be
inside.
Victims.
And we can hold that gendered approach very comfortably with psychological approaches of attachment, trauma, and strength-based engagement approaches. It doesn't have to exclude each other. We can hold multiple approaches and invite the mental health services, invite psychologists, invite mental health experts, as well as all the other people already that are engaged
okay,
in this conversation.
OK, we're just about out of time. Natasha wants to jump in and just respond briefly.
Our vision is of a violence-free Australia. I don't want anyone to be subject to violence in our community.
OK. We really don't have time for one more question. Let's take it anyway. It comes from Sophie Trower.
Hi, Rosie. I just wanted to say thank you on behalf of the audience and everyone watching at home. You're an incredible woman, so thank you. Rosie, what advice would you give to any women watching at home who are living with violence?
Advice, is it a good thing? I would say you stay safe, but it will never get better. And you deserve more. You deserve to live a life where you can wake up every day and not have to worry about the day ahead. What decisions you have to make, whether you're keeping yourself or your children. You know, there is a life that you don't have to live. But it is about safely. And I would suggest that you pick up the phone. And if you are in a very unhappy relationship, that you ring the 1-800 Respect and get put through to experts who can speak to you. Because if you do speak to the wrong people who do give you advice, tell you what to do, what they would do in your position, you don't feel supported, you don't feel empowered, you feel judged and criticised. So my advice would be to speak to the family service, violence services and the crisis lines that are there, who totally understand the position you're in. They're there not to tell you what to do, they're just there to support you. They empower you, but you know that you're going to make the decisions you can when you're ready. And that's, you know, you are the expert in your life, and it's when you're ready.
Thank you, Rosie. Thank you very much, and we will give you that number in a moment. That's all we have time for tonight. Please thank our panel, Charlie King, Rosie Batty, Natasha Stott, Despoja, Simon, Santosha and Tim Cartwright. Thank you. As I promised, a reminder that if you do need help, contact the National Family Violence Counselling Centre. The number is on your screen now. We'll put it up again later after the show if you don't have time to take it down. And we'll be back next Monday with the Assistant Treasurer, Jos Frydenberg, Labor backbencher, author and economist, Andrew Lee, star of stage and screen and, since her last appearance on Q&A, Australian citizen, Miriam Margolyes, Centre for Independent Studies policy analyst, Tricia Jha, and the editor-in-chief of Mamma Mia, Jamila Rizvi. Until next week's Q&A, good night.
If you or someone you know is affected by family violence, call the helpline number on your screen, 1-800-737-732.